So this is about time lapse. And why do I begin with this picture? These are babies, and they are extremely curious what is happening on the other side of the wall. Basically, we are all curious from birth, by nature. We can also say, if this would be an adult session, that time-lapse is as well, kind of like a pornography for embryologists. We would like to see what is happening behind the scenes. So with that starting out, I will discuss time-lapse. Why time-lapse is good? Why do we use it? Why Primo Vision is good? Why is it important to have a stress-free observation of embryos? And how we can use the information from time-lapse to make our life better, to make our selections better. I will discuss technology related to time-lapse. I will also discuss applications. What can we use time-lapse for? And I also will discuss some evidences in very, very brief. So I hope you will have some questions afterwards, what we can discuss in detail in person. Okay, technology. There is always some history behind things, and there is history behind Primo Vision as well. What is that history? Originally, our research group was not dealing with time-lapse. We were dealing with cell stress. We were stressing embryos and oocytes and sperm. And we wanted to have a system which can follow up embryo development without giving any stress while monitoring. So we wanted to have a zero-stress system that monitors embryo development automatically, only for our research. What does that mean? It means that we didn't want to move the dishes and the embryos at all, because that would come with shear stress, affecting embryos negatively. Second, light is an issue as well. So we wanted to have, so to say, zero phototoxicity system as well. And electric currents, even if they are very, very small, coming from a source of like an USB, they can have an effect. So we wanted to eliminate that one as well. With that, we wanted to have a system that is built around the embryo, which does not give any stress, because we wanted to avoid it completely. So what is the embodiment of the system? Let's take an incubator, a good one, a water jacket. This is mine in my lab. Let's look inside. We put a petri dish, the matrix of microwells in the middle. The embryos are sitting individually in these microwells, and they develop under a single droplet of media. This is like a group culture in microwells. What is the benefit? Benefit is that they still have the option to communicate with each other. So we have the autocrine and paracrine effects, but we can identify them individually since they are sitting individually in these microwells. I put this petri dish onto a top of an inverted microscope. These ones are compact digital inverted microscopes sitting individually in the incubator. They are assigned to one patient each. And then I close the door of the incubator and I can see the embryo development outside of the incubator. What do I see? These ones are developing in these microwells individually. This is the timeline. This one is the stages of development. 2 cell stage, 3 cell, 4 cell, 5M, blastulation and expansion. What you can see as horizontal yellow lines, they are, so to say, the reference values when these events are supposed to happen. This is the developmental graph of the embryo, embryo A and embryo B. You can see that these events at this embryo is falling within the reference values. This embryo is lagging behind with some reference values. Comparing these two embryos, I would say that morphokinetically, this one is better. By saying that, I say that morphokinetically, these events are falling closer to the reference values than with this embryo. So if I want to base my selection on morphokinetics, then I would vote for this one and not for that one. And again, we have to remember, all of this monitoring is done without providing any stress for the embryos. Let's sum it up, how it is complex solved technically. We believe, and we have evidence, that embryos cultured in group, they are developing, providing a better outcome, a better morphology, a better embryo quality. So we deal with true group culture. And we have the microscopes for the purpose. What is true group culture? True group culture, it doesn't mean that we just put embryos kind of like next to each other. They have to be in a certain distance in between each other. And tons of publications supporting it. So that one is fine-tuned in the microwell culture. This is what we use. In the microwells, they can develop their stable microenvironment, but since the embryo-to-embryo distance is optimized, they still can have the option to postulate to proper communication. About the microscopes, one of the innovations is that it has a humongous field of view. It means that this is the field of view, these are the microwaves. All the microwaves are within the same field of view. It means that nothing has to be moved during embryo culture. They are sitting still, nothing is moving. With one image, we are imaging everybody. And we can tell them, tell the difference between them by focusing onto the microwaves. Electromagnetic field. The microscopes are only switched on when there is image acquisition, for the milliseconds of image acquisition. And they are switched off outside of the incubator. This way, eliminating almost all electric effects. The light load is practically zero, since it's a digital technology. And the contrast is Hoffman contrast, so that we can see not just kinetics, but proper morphology on the microscopic images on our screen. How does it look in practice? Just an example. A bunch of small incubators stacked up on the wall. Each of these are containing two microscopes, and the information is sent outside to the single monitor, single kind of like working unit at the end of the lab. So that's how it looks, all of them. So what do? You take a dish, take a patient, all the embryos goes into a dish, put into this camera, close the door, and then you forget it. You are doing the decisions there, you are following up there. And when the 5 days is up, you can open the door of the incubator by knowing already which embryo you transfer, which one you selected for transfer, which one you cryopreserve, which one you discard. So everything is happening, your decision is outside, while they are developing completely undisturbed manner inside of the incubator. So that is how it is done in the practice. Applications. Embryo evaluation, but not only. Doing the evaluation without embryo handling, without disturbing them. They are in the incubator, I'm evaluating it while they are in the incubator. Embryo monitoring with time-lapse archives all moments of embryo development. It means that all the development, you have it on your hard drive, which is excellent for QC. And maybe equally importantly, that's the tool for communication. Communication between the MD and the embryologist, and the patient and the MD as well. So we should not forget these. But let's take that one. With time-lapse, we can have a lot more information without disturbing the embryo. So we still can keep the balance. Very, very briefly, what do we check with time-lapse? Time-lapse has taught us that morphology is dynamic. What we see morphologically, it's not the same. If we see the same event in time-lapse. If I would like to ask you that, what is that thing on the picture? It's a callous blastocyst, yes, that's right. How would you score it? Maybe you would not score it. But you would score this one. Maybe you would say it's a different embryo, but it's not. There is only like 20 minutes between them, or 15 minutes between them. Okay, blastocysts, they are dynamic, they are pulsating. So using time-lapse, we can judge them properly. Without time-lapse, we could not. If you had sharp eyes, you would see the producer particles here, how they arranged. This embryo, they are aligned nicely. This one, completely asymmetric. So the z-score of that embryo would be like z1. The Z of this embryo would be like Z2 or Z3. You would say they are two different embryos. They are not. There's only 1.5 hours in between them. So without time-lapse, I would not dare to score them. Let's check this one. Lots of fragments, continuously rearranging. Check out that big one there. It goes back into the blastomere. So what do we learn from that? We learn that fragmentations are dynamic as well. Proper judgment of the fragmentations is only possible with time-lapse. I don't want to go into details because this is the topic of like 97% of all the articles published about time-lapse. That besides describing the morphology properly, it is also a tool to get some physiological information out from the embryos. When do they cleave? How do they cleave? how long is the preparation phase, the interface? Is it a lot longer? Is it a lot shorter than the normal? It's supposed to be with a defined time frame. Tons of articles defining this method. So by checking the timings of events, we can get functional information out from the embryos, which is an addition to morphology. And then the topic of the cleavage pattern or cleavage normality. Let's take an example. You take an embryo out from the incubator and you can count 5 blastomers. What was the way for the 5 blastomers? Normally, from 1 to 2, and then this one cleaved, this one cleaved, and this one cleaved. That's a 5-cell stage embryo. Normal, nice. How about this one? After 2 cells, this blastomer cleaves to 3, this one cleaves to 2. Again a 5-cell stage embryo. How about this way? Directly from 3, and then this one and this one cleaves to 2. Again a 5-cell stage embryo. Morphologically, these 3, they look the same. What would you say about the function or the potential to become a proper fetus and a healthy offspring? This one has chance, proper chance. This mosaic one, this has a bit less chance. But this one, if you implant, that would definitely abort. Okay, so the chances are completely different, although their morphology is equal. This is going to be a topic of an excellent presentation in the afternoon, so please come back for that. So again, why do we use time-lapse? To judge morphology nicely, to follow up the normality of the cleavages, and to get some functional information based on the timings. And before we finish, I would like to mention some evidences for safety, some proof of concept, and some clinical studies. Safety evidence is supporting why is it good to culture without any stress. Published literature that if you open the door of the incubator many times, it's going to interfere negatively to your embryo development. It's better to keep them there without any disturbance. Light, tons of papers focusing on the light toxicity effect of the light. Shear stress, if the media is moving around the embryo, that is affecting the cytoskeleton, affecting negatively the embryo development. Tons of paper around it. And again, with the EMF, affecting negatively embryo development. All of these papers and a lot more supporting why stress-free monitoring is extremely important when you want to monitor embryos. Just 2 example papers, what we were publishing, early publications from Primo Vision. Animal studies, and based on the animal studies, we did the first human transfer of a single embryo, where the embryo was selected based on kinetic parameters, and that gave the birth of the first timeless baby. And of course, some clinical studies, which are either finished or ongoing, focusing onto the microwell, onto the culture of embryos in the microwells, and also focusing on using the system itself as a culturing tool and as a selection tool. Tons of articles published and quite a lot of finished or ongoing RCTs. Culturing in microwells, it has some history as well. It dates back like 14 years ago. It was originally used for making chimeras, aggregation of chimeras. But then it was used in the 2000s to culture the most sensitive cells, like cloned embryos of bovine and porcine. And then it became an excellent tool in the culture of human embryos as well. One of the RCTs is published here as a poster, so if you are interested, we can discuss this longer. And using time-lapse as a selection tool, together with the positive effects of the culture, we could also publish RCT results, like in last ESRM, showing a result that culturing in Primo and selecting a single embryo based on kinetic markers, including some morphology, gives improved results in pregnancy rate. And I would like to finish with this picture, who is Attila the Hun, so to say, who is the first timeless baby, just past 4 years old. And with that, I would like to thank for your attention. Thank you.